In an earlier module, we talked about service tiers. Now we're going to take a look under the hood and see how the various service tiers provide different levels of high availability. The first service tier we're going to talk about is general purpose. And I just wanted to set the stage with some of the things we already know. So what you're seeing here is an application. You're seeing some gateways and a control ring, and you're seeing a primary replica. Now, what we learned in our connectivity architecture, if you remember way near the beginning of this series, we talked about how you can set up redirect or proxy. So in the redirect situation, you go to the gateway and then straight to the database, and you don't go back to the gateway. And in the proxy situation, you always go to the gateway. So that's going to remain the same across most of these service tiers, actually all of these service tiers. And we're going to dive a little bit deeper into, you know, what's actually lying underneath.
Yeah, Anna, you know, if you think about how a failover cluster instance works for SQL Server, it's all about multiple SQL instances using shared storage. So in general purpose, you see the diagram here, we have a primary replica node with our SSD drive hosting things like tempdb, but our databases are on Azure Remote Storage. And data redundancy is automatically provided within the data center itself for these files. Now, backup files are in a different location using geo redundancy. So think about that for a second. Your backups in separate storage from your database files, you probably do the same thing in your data center. And then those have multiple redundancies, as we talked about during backup restore, in different regions. Now, if we need to do a failover, just like a failover cluster instance, what's going to happen is we're going to failover to a different node with a SQL server that's going to be started on that node, accessing the shared database files from Azure Premium Storage, just like a failover cluster instance, whereas the tempdb is still hosted on your local drive. Now, that recovery time to come back up depends on the spare capacity we have within the infrastructure to spin up another node running a SQL server. Recovery will kick in, but we're using accelerated database recovery, which we'll talk about later, to kind of help that process. And then SQL will start up, accessing the system databases, your user databases. It'll start up, and now your SQL server is available. And as Anna just talked about, instead of having your own type of listener concept like you do in a failover cluster instance scenario, we'll be using the power of these gateway servers with proxy and redirection to access your database. Now, the failover decisions that are made here are just a little bit like SQL Server, but instead of coordinating with something like Windows Failover Cluster, we're using the power of the service fabric to make decisions on when failover should occur. That's how general purpose works.
Thanks, Bob. So the next service tier that we're going to talk about, and this applies to both Azure SQL Database and SQL Managed Instance, is business critical. And what you're seeing here is very similar to what you saw at general purpose. So at a high level, we have our application. We're going to leverage the gateways in the control ring. And then depending on if you're using redirect and or proxy, you'll either always go to this gateway or you can then go straight to your database. And since it's business critical, we have your data, your log, including your tempdb, all running on this primary replica.
Yeah, I know. This is based on always-on availability group technology. So we're going to really kind of take advantage of the fact that the data is stored locally in your primary replica, but we're going to create for you automatically secondary replicas. And we'll always keep four of these replicas available at all times as much as possible. Now, the backup files, though, are in a different location again, just like general purpose, using geo redundancy. So again, it's a great story here. Your backups are separate than your database files, and they're kept in a geo redundancy location. Now, for commits of your transaction, a little similar to availability groups, at least one of these secondaries must be in synchronization with the primary for a commit to succeed. We need to do this to ensure we can meet the SLA requirements that we give you with business critical. When we do need to do a failover, similar to general purpose, the logic is going to be based on an integration of SQL Server and Service Fabric. But the recovery time is extremely fast, just like an availability group on-premise. Remember, we're switching over to an always SQL server that's running, redoing log transactions. So in a failover scenario, we just have to run undo recovery, which again, with accelerated database recovery, which you're going to learn about later, is very, very fast. So recovery can be extremely fast compared to general purpose. Now, again, connectivity redirection built in, as Anna described, how we use gateways, proxy, and redirection. And here's the great thing. If you use business critical for free, one of these replicas can then be used for read capabilities. So that's business critical, built in high availability.
Awesome. Now, the last service tier that we have to talk about is the hyperscale service tier. And today, this is only in Azure SQL Database, so that's what we're talking about today. And at the beginning, it looks slightly different, but it's really the same. In the back end, you're going to have an application. You're still going to be leveraging a gateway and a control ring.
Yeah, Anna, this architecture is really unique. And we use a combination of local caches of local drives and something called a paired page server. So you're seeing these compute nodes, which are actually like your primary type replicas with these caching. And then in the middle, you're going to have something called a page server. These page servers are going to hold, kind of like caches of database pages that are connected to the primaries. Now, the data files themselves are stored on Azure storage. And you're thinking, is this going to be slower than general purpose? No, it's really amazing. Because the fact that we have page servers and caches, this caching system is going to give us great performance. But guess what? Since the database and files are on Azure storage, we can take advantage of snapshot technology to make backup and restore extremely fast and not even dependent on the size of these things. You're going to be able to do restores in just incredible time. Now, we have something called a log service. A log service is not like an availability group service, but it's similar in the sense that we're going to use log changes to feed these replicas. Now, if you look at this diagram here, you see primary and secondaries. So you can have 0 to 4 secondary replicas for read, scale, and failover capabilities.
Now, hey, Bob.
Yeah.
Why would we have 0 replicas? What does that even, why would you do that?
Yeah, it doesn't make sense. Like, Anna, we showed this is critical. We had multiple replicas, and you need that for high availability. But consider this architecture. The data files are on Azure storage, and then we use page servers and local caches for that data. So technically with hyperscale, you don't even need a replica for high availability because, like general purpose, if the primary went down, we could spin up a new node and we could use our page servers and caches and data stores from remote storage to bring up the new primary replica. But I'm sure you want better performance than that, so we have the ability to do 0 to 4. So if you go all the way to 4 replicas, you're going to actually have a faster failover experience than if you had 0 replicas. So it's kind of, in a way, if you think about it, combining the best of both worlds from what we've done with general purpose and business critical, giving you maximum performance and scalability.
Awesome. Thanks, Bob. This is really interesting. You know, one other comment I have, and, you know, I think I had hinted about this before, but it says SQLServr.xc, but it's missing an E. Is there a story there?
Anna, you're showing your age once again. SQL Server, that word without the E is 8 characters. That's an old DOS restriction. When in the day, when we first launched SQL Server, before you were born, you know, SQL Server names had to be 8 characters. And by the way, you can imagine in our infrastructure, no one in their right mind is ever going to want to go change it past those 8 characters. So yes, it is a DOS legacy that we have the characters of SQLServr.exe. So, yeah, great question and way to show our age differences, Anna. Thanks for adding that to the color of today's video.
Yeah, Bob, it was too good not to bring up. So thanks for explaining, you know, for some of us younger folks, we appreciate it. Thanks for joining us in this video where we talked about the high availability architectures underneath each of the service tiers, and we learned a fun fact about SQL Server XE. See you in the next video.